Hello, welcome, welcome, welcome. Come on in, make yourself at home, bring your cup of tea, get comfy, and I'm just letting everyone kind of get in the room. It is so lovely to see you here, fresh as a daisy on a Monday morning. Hopefully the weather is good near you. It was sunny here, but it's got a little cloudy now. We always like to start the week with a little weather conversation. It's very British, isn't it? Lovely to see everyone. Welcome today. We are really excited talking about mastering your money. Important conversation. And I think sometimes it doesn't get enough attention because we are really attracted to like shiny, sparkly things. Let's talk about TikTok. Let's talk about all the fun things. But actually, running your business well, thinking about the money stuff can make such a difference, huge difference to you and your small business. This is part of our partnership with Lloyds Bank Academy. And you can see on your screen, which will disappear in a second, we've got an amazing panel here today. We are recording this. You will be able to catch up if there's anything that you miss. In my experience of these Q&A sessions, it can go pretty thick and fast. And so you might want to kind of dip back in afterwards to catch up on an answer or something that you weren't sure about. I can see you have all joined the chat, which is amazing. Please do join and say hi, introduce yourself, where you're from. However, if you have a question, and we've had so many sent in advance, so we're going to see how many we can get through. If you do have a question, can I encourage you to put it in the Q&A box at the bottom, just because the chat tends to move so fast that we might miss something. So, we're going to kick off. I'm going to take the little screen down now, and I'm going to introduce you to our panel today. Our wonderful panel of experts who will be speed answering all your questions today because we have hundreds of them. I'm going to go just around the room as I see it. So I'll start with Sue, then Suzanne, and then Michael. So, Sue, do you want to introduce yourself?
Good morning, everyone. I'm Sue Pettigrew from Simple Commercial Finance. Just to let you know that I did worked for 21 years at a different bank, looking after businesses of all sizes. And now I'm a commercial broker, which means that any finance needs, I can go out to anybody in the marketplace to support that.
Any finance needs? We're very excited.
Yes.
Okay. Suzanne, over to you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Suzanne Spicer, and I'm a chartered accountant, and I run Spicer and Co. We're a family-run firm of chartered accountants based in Bedfordshire, and we help loads of SMEs locally and nationally.
Amazing. Thank you very much, Suzanne. Michael.
Hi everyone, good morning. I'm Mike Robinson and I'm a chartered accountant. I'm based over in Cheshire at a firm called HLB, and I've been an accountant for 30 years now for all my sins. But the good thing is looking after small business all that time.
No sins at all. No sins at all. We love accountants. We love accountants. Right, we're going to just jump straight in if that's okay, because we've got quite a lot to cover today. I want to chat a little bit first about cash flow management. Now, before you all fall asleep, and this is more exciting than it sounds, as one of the things that we find is that small business can be really focused on the top line and constantly going out and selling, trying to sell and trying to drive sales, when actually giving a bit more thought to how you run the business maybe doesn't sound so sexy, but actually this can be where the real results are made. Having a really clear view of your cash flow, having a really good idea about where that money that comes in works for you, maybe at where you can cut costs, for example. So being smarter about the business rather than constantly trying to drive that top line. So we're going to dip into cash flow questions. So I'm getting some water delivered. So number one question, how can I boost cash flow when sales are low? This sounds like something that we'd love to do. I'm going to come to Sue.
So I think boosting your cash flow in sales low is about actually just thinking about, can you add anything else onto that particular sale? So it doesn't really always matter what your widget is. It's almost like that. So I noticed one had said about in a salon, can you upsell some shampoo? Can you upsell, conditioner, something like that, or a product that you're particularly using as well? And just think about it from that viewpoint as well, I would say.
It's a really good point, actually, because we've heard from a lot of people really the last couple of years, particularly with the cost of living crisis, footfall is down. But doesn't mean that it's completely dead, that still there are still people coming, whether you're in person or whether it's online. So getting a bit more out of that sale every time, rather than trying to go and get another person to come along. I love that. Suzanne, any thoughts to add on this one?
Really, that, you know, upsell if you can, but also make sure you get the cash in as quickly as you can as well, because that then, you know, the quicker you get your cash flow through the door, the better it is for you. You don't walk out of Tesco's without paying for your shopping basket. So, you know, make sure you get that money through the door. And there are lots of ways now, you know, with technology that you can get that cash cheap as well.
That's such a good point. And we've had a lot of conversations around late payments for small businesses, and particularly if you're not, if, I mean, for B2C businesses, obviously you're getting paid at the point of sale, but if not, keeping on top of those invoices, reminding people, making sure you got the right payment terms, and there's loads of technology, do it automatically for you. One of the things that we've seen as well is some of this technology is allowing it, but being able to take card payments, you know, maybe you're accounting platform will now also have an add-on to let you take card payments. That might speed up. Speed up getting the money in. Pressing on, because we've got like about 1,000 questions. Michael, I'm going to come to you. And thinking about, again, thinking about the cash flow, not just kind of maximizing what's coming in and what in the door, but managing it on a daily basis. You are an experienced accountant, and I want to stay on top of my finances on a daily basis. Is there something easy that I can do that's going to help me understand where I'm at quite regularly, rather than just waiting for like every 6 months my bookkeeper or accountant to tell me what's going on?
Well, yes. And of course, we can talk about how do we improve cash flow and talk about income and expenses. But the most important thing before you can do any of that is understand where you are now. If you don't know where you are now, then how do you know what your costs are and where you're going to go? So, of course, you touched on accounting software. Brilliant. Businesses out there should be keeping track of their income and expenses. Yeah, your accountant, speak to them. What are they using? Do they suggest a certain type of software that you can use that they can support you with? But you don't need to go that advanced. It could be as simple as get a piece of paper, write down your income, write down your expenses, get a sheet of Excel, maybe not chalk and slate, but that type of stuff. You need to know where you are now so that you can look at your costs to plan where you're going to go in the future. That's where I would start.
And there's a question in the Q&A, which I thought was a good one to just take a step back on. And Michael, I'm going to stick with you on this, let you have a mouthful of tea first. But what is the difference between revenue and cash flow?
Right, okay. So cash flow, I suppose we're thinking about what actual money are we getting into our bank and what type of expenses are going out of our bank therein that day. That's our cash in and out every day. Now, some businesses like a salon we talked about before, well, we know that our revenue is going to be the money that we took into our shop that day. So they're going to be roughly the same. But there's going to be businesses that are going to send out invoices to their customers that are their revenue today, but we're not going to see that cash for 30 days or 60 days. So we can't really bank that money in our head until that cash comes in. So we've got a paper invoice, which is different from that cash coming in the door today.
I think that was a really good explanation. Thank you, Michael.
I try.
No, it's awesome. And it's different, of course. You know, if you're a B2C, or, you know, we said about Tesco, you know, when you sell something in Tesco, the cash comes sort of immediately. Although if you're using a credit card, there might be, you know, if your customer's using a credit card, there might be a delay in you getting that cash. But it's a bit closer than if you've got an invoice and then you've got a, and then there's a whole process afterwards as well. So hopefully that was helpful. Just on that, actually, what is... This is a big conversation. What is normal payment terms in industries? Oh, well, there's, how long's a piece of string? Sue, did you, I saw your face.
I think it absolutely goes down to, you know, I've seen it as long as 90 days. You know, again, depending on the size of the company, it feels quite often the bigger the company and more global they are, the longer the terms, because of course then they're keeping money in their bank account and not giving it away to anybody else. And again, just using like Tesco as an example, you see that quite frequently with the bigger kind of companies. But I think in the main, you know, I've seen it 14-day terms, occasionally seven, but I think 14 and 30 in my experience tends to be quite normal. But I'll bow to the accountants on the call as well in case they differ.
I'm going to chip in a little bit. Just the government's there's been loads of reviews over the last few years around late payments and actually not just late payments but good payment terms. So, you know, they would always encourage that if you're paying small business that you should pay on 30 days. That should be encouraged. Of course, massive companies often don't do that, and there's a big, but then lots of organizations have committed to doing that or less, actually, you know, just to pay the invoice when it comes in, which, you know, if you're using small businesses to manage your treasury function, you maybe want to question whether that's completely ethical. But certainly here in, so industries like a lot of manufacturing, farming, for example, you could see 180-day payment terms, which is not great. But what we're increasingly seeing is small businesses clubbing together to say, no, this is, we want 30-day payments or we're not going to do the work. And that's hard to do, isn't it? You know, when you want the job, you want to work with this big organization. What do you think, Suzanne?
Yeah, I mean, I tend to tell my clients, you know, any more than 30 days that you're asking for trouble, because as a small business, you've got staff to pay potentially, you've got yourself to pay because you might have your mortgage or your rent and everything else. So cash flow is really king to you at the end of the day. So as a small business, I mean, I see nothing wrong with pushing for 7 or 14 or making people sign up to the direct debit. So the minute it's due, you get that money straight into your bank anyway.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. It does seem to be that sort of, you know, industry standard is 30 days anymore. Like, I think you can legitimately look down your nose at these people. So, dude. And some people are saying in the comments, I can see about paying in advance. And absolutely, you know, when you set up that contract, when you negotiate in the first place, you, I think, pushing for what you want. And I think you have pride in the product or service that you're delivering as well. You know, you're worth it, Herr Swish.
Yeah.
You
are. I think, you know, sorry to interrupt you there, Michelle. I think I look after a double glazing company, and they always do it as 50, 30, 20. So they take 50% up front to do the order, 20% on actual delivery of the goods, and then 30% on delivery of goods, and then 20% on completion. So a customer isn't paying for everything up front, but that's in their terms. And it's like, without that deposit, we ain't even ordering your goods.
Yeah.
And so again, I think it depends on the particular, you know, industry as well that people are in.
You do. And I think Suzanne made a great point. Of course, if you're paying staff, they have to be paid every 30 days because people will stop coming to work if you stop paying them. So I think especially in service industries or anything that's staff intensive, that's a great, like, it's a great argument to push back on and say, look, staff need paying. You've got to pay us.
Yeah.
I'm going to move on because there's a lot of other questions on this. There's one question that I think it's a really important one, and I think we should teach this in schools, and we're never going to cover it all today. How do you read a profit and loss? And like, I hear you, I absolutely hear you. Are there any like just quick tips? Maybe Michael, could you give us a couple of quick tips on this one? And then we can work on campaigning for kids to be taught at school, because I really think we should.
No, well, and I agree that they should, because we have apprentices that come out of school and don't understand what some basic numbers mean, and so we train them up. But a basic way of reading a profit loss, what I would say about all the conversations that we've had today, maybe number one is make sure that you're speaking to a professional, because I realise as a small business, we want to save money. But sometimes if we speak to an accountant or someone in finance or a legal person, they have that expertise to explain it to us. So that would be my starting point. But then blindly, if I had a profit and loss in front of me, I suppose key numbers for anyone to look at is going to be our sales figure. Of course, we all know what sales is. That's how much is going out the door. So is our sales up or down on last year? So that's a nice basic starting point. And then other key things that people talk about are gross profit and net profit. And before I scare people, all these terms, ultimately, a profit and loss has shown us, have we got more sales over expenses for the year or more expenses over sales? So, of course, if we've got more sales, we've made a profit. And if we've got more expenses, we've made a loss. Now, it might be in a format that looks a bit tricky, but if we look at the top number and the bottom number and concentrate on those, and then if they're going up, that's great. If they're going down, it's not so great. And that would be a very basic way of thinking about a profit or loss in 20 seconds.
20 seconds. No, do you know what, though? It's really well put. I remember when the pandemic hit 4 years ago, and there was sort of so many people had to reassess their businesses very quickly because, you know, the world shifted overnight. And I had so many conversations with small businesses saying that they hadn't sat down and really looked at their numbers for such a long time. And in some cases it was good, in some cases it was not so good. And really understanding how profitable their business actually was. How much does each sale cost me? And that's where when we talk about productivity, which sounds like such a boring word, does sound like a boring word. But actually, if you can make, to Michael's point, if you can make your sales cost less, then that's going to help your bottom line, which is actually the most important one anyway, because that's what you're going to bank at the end of it, you know, whether that's going to pay you some money, whether you can pay yourself dividends, or whether you can reinvest in the business. So kind of maybe putting a bit more space between the top line and the bottom line, which comes to my next question about productivity in the business. Any tips on productivity, particularly for micro businesses? I think, you know, most businesses UK are micro businesses, so you can't just go and, you know, send your like senior managers out to do some productivity gains. Like you're it, you know. Suzanne, what are your thoughts?
I think keeping a track of your overheads. A lot of people will do a software audit, for example, every so often, just to make sure you, all those subscriptions that you don't use anymore, they're costing you money. So it's something, you know, just do it once in a while, just to make sure that you're actually using what you're paying for. Just keeping track of your costs and seeing what potentially you can source elsewhere for cheaper, just to make your overall expenses less onerous, is a good thing to do. I'm seeing a lot of businesses doing at the moment. We're in a very uncertain year with the election coming up, and a lot of people are looking at what they're spending.
Yeah, and it's a good discipline to do that, though, isn't it? And
absolutely. Yeah.
Do it more often. And it's funny how many people, you know, so many people who are like, oh God, I just don't want to talk to, like this idea, if I talk to my accountant, or God forbid, HMRC, like money will just leave me by osmosis in some way, like something awful will happen. But we need to flip it on its head a little bit and go, no, this is a good thing. Let's look at our costs. We love looking at costs. You're nodding a lot there, Sue.
Yeah, I think it is. And I think Suzanne's absolutely right about the thing of just like, you know, actually, what things are you paying for? And I think even if you do it personally, have a little like cleanse of your bank account and go, hang on a minute, why am I paying Amazon Music plus, you know, another, you know, provider like Spotify and whoever, you know, and suddenly you look and you think, hold on a minute, I'm paying out for three products that are the same kind of thing here. And so I think sometimes you even need to do it as a discipline, as I say, there as well as in your business, because it's a good thing just to reflect and see what's costing you what, really. And also, don't be afraid to actually, you know, go and actually see how much you can get something. I mean, you know, we've all, or a lot of us, will have things like cars and stuff like that. You know, don't be afraid if you've got more than one vehicle to think about, can you get a better cost if it's a fleet insurance rather than it only being, you know, single cars and stuff like that. And, you know, personally, I have a multi-car one for us at home, and I rang up because it had gone up like 50%. But I took the phone call and thought, I'm going to do it, ring up. 10 minutes later, suddenly I'm not paying quite as much as I was. So I think it's always worth. And if it's a no, well, actually, it's 10 minutes worth spent knowing that actually you've got the best deal that's out there at the minute.
Yeah. And I do think we've had a lot of questions coming in about rising operational costs. And we've seen this across the board, you know, with inflation and interest rates rises, cost of living rises, you know, the costs have gone up, you know, across the board. So it's a great thing. And we talked about this in the pandemic, you know, just to, whether you don't even need to do it in software, but like get your bank, just go through what's coming out regularly, just go through and go, Can I get that a bit cheaper? You know, yeah. And it's always worth giving people a call, right? It's always worth it. You never know where you might be able to shave off a few pennies. Forecasting. I know we're racing through these because there's so many questions. A few questions around forecasting. And particularly if you, you know, thinking, I'm going to think about the next 6 months, what's going to come in. So in order to plan, to make a bit of a plan, but there are peaks and troughs. And of course, the economy is a little bit, you know, a bit all over the place. And Suzanne, you mentioned a couple of things that might be impacting that, particularly at the moment. How can I forecast if things are not quite consistent? I'll come to Michael then, Suzanne, if that's all right.
Well, I think I'm going to repeat myself. I think, well, you need to start off with knowing where you are now. And get a nice big piece of Excel and then plot down where you are now. And okay, so if we think about an ice cream seller, just because it's nice and simple, if the weather was a bit better, we'd be expecting to be buying more ice creams today, but of course we're not. And I think really as a business owner, we're going to be making a judgment of, well, actually, we're going to be selling more ice creams in the summer than what we are in the winter, I'd assume. So on that piece of Excel, maybe we've got our constant of what we feel our underlying sales are going to be each month. But then on our piece of Excel, we can say, well, as a business owner, I feel like my sales are going to be up 50% in the summer and they're going to be down 20% in the winter. And through that, we can use a little bit of formulas on our Excel sheet to try and work out the peaks and troughs in that income and match it to our expenses as well, which then links into our cash flow, which will show us, hopefully, our cash is up in the summer, but of course it's going to be down in the winter. So therefore, we might need to save some of the cash from the summer to help us through the winter. So Excel is where I'd start on a basic level.
Suzanne, did you want to add anything to that?
Be wary of tax payments in your cash flow. It's always worth, you know, your ice cream seller was going to be busy in the summer, but he's got a self-assessment tax bill potentially to pay on the 31st of January. So you need to build these things into your cash flow. If you're registered for VAT, you'll have quarterly or monthly payments as well. So don't think just about the business. Just remember the tax side of it as well. You could have VAT, personal tax, corporation tax if you're a limited company. So there's other things to build in as well. If you're forecasting over a year, you might need to think about wage rises for staff or national minimum wage rises if you're working in something like hairdressing or retail. So don't forget to build these in, because we've had quite significant national minimum wage rises recently and they do have a huge impact on small businesses.
Yeah, you're right. There's been quite a few changes, and it's interesting. We talk about the election this Thursday. We're trying to be an election-free zone for an hour because I know there's a lot of it in the press at the moment. But I do, people can kind of tune out when you hear things about budgets, and you know, Rachel Reeves has said the budget will be in the next 10 weeks and blah blah blah. And all this doesn't matter for me. It absolutely does matter for you, because if there's a change that's coming in either immediately or possibly at a horizon like maybe end of March next year, that's going to impact you and your forecast. So it's really good to pay attention to this. And we'll come back actually, you know, in September when we have the next budget and talk about how it impacts small businesses. So hopefully that can help you with that. So a question for you, like, how often should we be doing this forecasting?
So I would say I'd be doing it fairly frequently. I don't think it needs to be done kind of every week or anything like that. But like, I think it goes back to what Michael said before, is know where you are. I think it possibly depends slightly on the business and how it's performing as well. And actually, what is actually the longer term gain? So if somebody's wanting to grow their business, they might want to do, you know, a forecast more frequently to see how they are against it. I think we're, and I've been guilty of this as well, of, I think sometimes we're so absorbed in the day-to-day activities that you work in the business, you forget to work on the business, and there is a difference. So what I mean by that is if you're in it and you're kind of in doing all the stuff every day, you sometimes need to just take a bit of a step back, put some time in your diary if you can, block out half an hour and just sit and have a look at where you are. It goes back exactly what Mike said, know where you are at what point. It might be actually, you know, good to do it every quarter. It might be that you do it every 6 months. But I think also some of it will be dictated by, I know there's a lot of questions about funding, whether people want funding and things like that as well. But I think you should stop and take stock, you know, at least periodically. So, you know, definitely do that periodically. I'll take the advice of the accountants on here, how more frequently they think. But I'd be thinking possibly once a quarter as a minimum.
Once a quarter? Good way.
I'd be happy with that, because the thing is also is think about what you're going to use it for. So if it's for day-to-day management and planning of the business, then yeah, once a quarter might be fine. If you're going to use it for someone in finance and they really want some active figures before they make a decision if they're going to give you funding, then it might be that you need to be reviewing it and updating it more constant, because you're going to be giving it to them on a more regular basis.
That was actually my next question. So let's just pick that one up, which is about if you are thinking about forecasting because you want to go, you may be going big, you might be going out for some external equity finance, but, you know, more likely maybe you want a loan from the bank, or you want to go out for some kind of debt finance. What kind of forecasting do you need? Like, how much detail do you need? How far ahead do you need to do that?
Well, I think, and it might be the others disagree, but I think that the first thing you should do is speak to the person who you're dealing with in the finance company or the grant body, wherever you're applying to, because every forecast looks different. And so don't waste time preparing this nice, big, shiny thing that no one wants. Find out what they want and then do that. And that is the best way of knowing what you need to achieve. Find out what you need to do first.
I love that. Have you had any experience of that, Sue and Suzanne? I'll come to both of you on that.
Suzanne, do you want to go first?
Yeah, definitely. Some of the banks will have their own formats for this. So it's always worth, as Michael said, totally agree with him, to check what requirements are to start with, and then you can work from there. You haven't wasted any time. You haven't incurred some fees from your accountant that were a complete waste of time either. So you're all starting from the right place. There are so many different formats that this can come in. I would say if I was to generalise, you're probably looking at least a year's forecast for funding.
Yeah, I was going to say, actually, in my banking experience, we used to generally ask for 2 years, because you wanted to kind of see, were you breaking even on year one? And then actually, what were you doing in year two? But I think some of it also you've got to bear in mind is depends on how long you've been established, obviously, as a business too. Mm-hmm. So if you've been established for a long time and you've got a really, you know, strong track record, it might be that actually you don't need to actually have a forecast. It might just be that we're using your existing, you know, financial accounts. But if you are changing, you know, something a little bit drastically, then they are going to want to see kind of some evidence of, well, how have you arrived at this? And the other thing that people, I think, sometimes don't always get right is they're making some assumptions. Like, what are you making that assumption on? You know, mm-hmm. So is it historic things? Is it stuff that actually tangibly you know, but where have you got that evidence from? You know, so suddenly, you know, if you're getting something and you know that I'm going to just use insurance again, you know, actually, have you thought about how much the insurance will now cost you moving forward if it's for a particular reason? And it might again be worth a quick phone call going, if I do X, Y, and Z, how much my insurance go up by? Because it's those kind of things that come back to bite you on the bottom, usually, where you haven't thought about certain aspects.
Thank you. Suzanne, something that you touched on, I'm going to just kind of slightly veer off on. You mentioned accounting fees, and I've seen that some questions around this. So some questions around, do I need, particularly for new business, do I need a bookkeeper? Do I need a bookkeeper and an accountant? Do I just need an accountant? Should they be costing me a lot of money? What should I be spending lots on? Like, what? Help me with this. So Suzanne, as you brought it up, I'll come to you, but I'll come to Michael to talk about
it. It is a bit of a minefield, isn't it? It does fall down to preference of the business owner at the end of the day, if you want a separate bookkeeper to the separate accountant. I prefer to do the whole service for somebody, because it as an accountant, I get a better feel for what the business is doing. If I'm involved in the day-to-day bookkeeping, you know, we're filing the VAT returns, you can see what's going on and you are quicker there to identify a trend or point something out to the client. If something's not quite going in the right direction, you're on top of the numbers and you can point it out to them. So it does fall down to preference. Some people say, oh, you know, I've known Peggy since the day dot and she's going to do my bookkeeping, so you only need to do my accounts. It's individually really on a basis by basis, but there are advantages to having everything in one place, I believe, certainly from a tax perspective as well, because you can identify if someone's making, you know, a lot of money in 3 months, I'd say, hang on a minute, you might need to register for VAT. Are you putting some money aside for your tax bills? Because you've got to kind of potentially have a big one coming up. So it's being on the ball to be able to identify those opportunities and threats, really. Fee-wise, it's a whole minefield. It's going to vary very much from region to region and what services you're looking for. But I'm happy to bring Michael in on this as well.
Thanks. What I would say is when it comes to accountancy fees, you need to think about first, who do I want to be my accountant, as silly as that sounds, because there's many different types of accountants out there. I'm a chartered accountant, so is Suzanne. There might be people out there that are accountants but have no form of qualifications, and they're accountants as well. And then you need to think to yourself, well, actually, what type of service do I want? Do I want to go cheap but maybe not cheerful? Because that might not give you the right answer at the end of the year, and so it might cost you more money. But then you might look at a price and think, oh, that sounds expensive, but then not realise the service that is going on in the background for you. And of course, if you're an accountant, you're seeing them just once a year, that's going to cost less than you've seen them all through the year. But what I would say is, especially for a small business that is looking to grow, that you need to be communicating with your accountant, with your professional advisors, often. If you're seeing your accountant once a year, you haven't got the opportunity to identify problems, to fix the problems before you move on. That's maybe the old way. And then the new way is with the support of software, that your software is always up to date, your numbers are always up to date. I know where I am, I can forecast, I can look at my cash flow. But of course, all that interaction means more fees. So with everything, there's good and bad, a bit like the Muller Rice advert, good and bad.
Well, you touched on the software just then, and we've had a lot of questions asking for what's the best accounting software recommendations. And I find this can be very much down to the preference of the individual. Well, I'll ask everyone's opinion on this one, particularly for kind of small businesses, micro businesses. You know, we work a lot with Xero on our Small and Mighty program, and they actually have a free version of the software if you're really small. And there, you know, there's QuickBooks, there's Sage, which tends to be for slightly bigger businesses, but they do have offer for smaller businesses. There's the other one, which I'm going to forget. You guys are going to
free agents.
And these are probably like the bigger ones that you probably would have heard of. And I think, you know, and the guys, I'd like your views on these. Was I'd like to say other products are available, but some of it is like, you know, what does your accountant use? What does your bookkeeper use? And that can help to guide you. But also just have a little look at the software interface. And some of these things have got, particularly like small businesses who aren't sitting at a laptop all day, some of them have got little apps on your phone. So you can just look in and go, you know, has that money come in? If it's linked straight up to your bank account, you know, have I got much coming out this month? Do I need to think about what's my cash flow situation? So you can get, you know, it can really help you stay on top of things. And this technology is getting better and better and better all the time, which is encouraging. Do you guys have a favorite software?
If I go first, I'd say no, and that's because each software, it does the same. It adds up numbers and comes out with a total. They all do the same, but they all do it different ways. And so if I was looking for what software to use, the first thing I'd do is speak to my accountant. What do they like? What do they support? Secondly, there might be something very unique about my business. So, for example, if I'm a gas fitter and I'm with Gas Safe, they might have a piece of software that links into Xero or QuickBooks or Free Agent. So actually, I want to look at something that might trade and what links into these software, because then you're going to get the benefit of linking across. They all do the same. And Free Agent, well, yes, that's free if you bank with NatWest. Xero and QuickBooks, well, I think you pay for that, but sometimes your accountant can do deals on it. The other thing that I like, well, sort of, sad accountant, is that some of these softwares now have turned into mobile phones. We can get all these apps that add on. And so I had a client who we talked about debt collection before and overdue invoices. So there might be a piece of software that links into your accounting records that will start chasing for these sales invoices for you without you even thinking about it. So to look at the features of the software, speak to your accountant, they all do the same. They all do the same. They just look different, they do the same.
Any other thoughts? Sue, what are your thoughts?
I just can't add anything other than, like you say, you know, I think depending on the system, some of them, like you were saying before, you've got apps, you can take a photo of an invoice or payments you've maybe been to, you know, get some products, and you can just take a photo of that receipt and it uploads it into the system, and then you can match it back and stuff. So it makes your life a bit easier. But yeah, I just think, again, it depends on the person, and depends on the situation. And, you know, if Free Agent works for you and it's free with your NatWest account, well, why wouldn't you take it potentially? But again, totally everything that Michael said, I've got nothing really further to add.
Suzanne, any thoughts?
Only really to add to Michael's, there are banks like Coconut that on the app allow you to categorize your income and expenses. There are some software such as Wave. Wave is free, but because it's US-based, it's no good if you are VAT registered. So a lot of the smaller ones are great if you're not VAT registered. So Coconut, the Tide app, for example, was very good. Wave, free. But if you are VAT registered, you are going to need one of the bigger boys, Free Agent, Xero, QuickBooks, one of these really at the end of the day. And most accountants will tend to go with what you would prefer. They don't restrict you to any specific software. It is your choice at the end of the day. So, but look at the features, as Michael said. Look at the features, look at the cost. Xero have put their price up again. It's going up 10% in September, which seems to be an annual thing now. But yeah, and there are different versions. So Xero has about three different versions. So don't just look at the most expensive one. Look at the cheap one to see if it will fit your needs.
So there's two things I want to pick up from there. One is, I wanted to answer Zeenat's question just on the software. All of these software providers have got training on their websites. So there's like plug and play. There's, you know, little videos that can help you use it. There's sessions that they'll run to go along. So do go and have a little look, because it can be a bit confusing. You mentioned VAT, Suzanne. So a couple of things, lots of questions around VAT. There's always that. So one question is from someone saying, if I don't pay VAT, if I'm not big enough to pay VAT, do I still need an accountant? I'm pretty sure that there's going to be nods around the room, because you're still going to have to file accounts, even if you're not VAT registered. And at the moment, the threshold for VAT is 90,000, and that may or may not change in the next budget. But it's definitely worth keeping an eye on that for you and your business. And there's a bit of a conversation around, I'd like to grow as a business. There's lots of people who want to grow as a business, want to be a successful business, but they're worried about that VAT threshold. What are we going to say to businesses like that? Sue, what would you say? Business worried about the threshold?
I think I would actually point them back to my counterparties on this call and go speak to your accountant about it. Because, you know, in really simplistic terms, you're suddenly going to be paying, you know, 20%, or maybe not. It might be a slightly different amount depending on the situations. So actually, if you are growing, you almost have to grow to potentially a bigger amount to actually gain back the same kind of value. And what I mean by that is because suddenly you're having to pay it out. And I've seen it before in a gym where actually all of a sudden they needed to actually get X amount of members more to make it more viable for them because they were paying the VAT. So my advice would be go speak to your professional advisor.
Right, professional advisors. What are our thoughts, Suzanne?
It's difficult. It depends if you're B2B or B2C. If you're B2B, VAT is not an issue because they're all VAT registered anyway. So you charging them the extra 20% if it's standard rated goods or services is not an issue. Problem more tends to come if you are selling to consumers who are not VAT registered, who have then got an extra 20% to pay for their haircut or having their nails done or whatever it might be. That's when it becomes slightly more difficult to try and establish, am I better off by doing this or not? And again, speak to your advisors is definitely the right answer.
Michael, any thoughts?
Yeah, so if you like, we've got two different businesses, both with a £50,000 turnover. One is quite happy doing 50 grand every year, and that's what they've been doing. So they don't need to think about that, and they don't need to think about that. Do they need an accountant? Yeah, but at the same time, if they know what they're doing and slot the numbers on the tax return, yeah, okay, fine. But that same business with 50 grand turnover, they're looking to grow because we've talked about forecasting and they want to grow. So therefore, they need to be very aware of that registration threshold that you mentioned of £90,000. If we're not keeping track of our money and keeping an eye on it, as I've seen many people do before, go over that registration threshold, been unaware of it, and then a few months later, we need to register for VAT. But now we need to go and find all that extra cash to go and pay all the VAT that we should have been paying for those last few months, and that becomes very painful. So we need to be keeping track of our numbers before the event happens rather than trying to fix the event after it's already happened. So that's my thought on VAT. Where your business is going is how you should be keeping track of it.
If you take one thing from Michael today, it is know where you're at. Know where you're at today.
That's the pattern, isn't it? But that really, really solves the problem. If you don't know where your business is at now, then some event is going to happen in the future and it's too late to fix it.
And the, just to clarify, Barrett's asking the question, 90K refers to, that's the sales, so not your VAT, but it's your sales revenue that goes over 90,000.
Yes.
My feeling is I don't think businesses should be scared of the 90,000 threshold, because if you're big enough to scale over it, well, this is good. You're growing. This is a good thing. As Michael says, you should know about this in advance. I think there's a lot of confusion, which is why you should talk to a professional, because, of course, you can reclaim back VAT on even if you're a B2C business. A lot of your expenditure, so if you're buying products for your business, often you then reclaim the VAT off that. So depending on what your expenses are for your business, you might be able to reclaim quite a lot of that VAT, which you weren't doing before. So it's not necessarily like just a 20% haircut on all your sales. So remember that. I think the other thing is, if you're planning to scale, kind of as Michael said, you know, registering for VAT early and having a cost base that allows for that means that you're not suddenly going to have to be more expensive when you go over the threshold. You're not suddenly going to have to adjust your business model as you grow. If you kind of start a business and think, yeah, I'd like to be 100K sales business in the next year or two, just start out registered for VAT. And I do think it's different now to how it was even 10 years ago. So, you know, I've been in business quite a long time, I'm older than I look. I remember the days of piles of, and I'm sure accountants do, piles of receipts, boxes of receipts, scanning in a receipt at a time. That was like got a bit better, but you know, huge amounts of paperwork. Now we're completely paper free in our VAT return. The bank gets sucked into the accounting software, all the invoices, they're either digital or we make them digital and pop them in there. The process is much quicker. It's much more seamless because professionals and software together make it so. It doesn't have to be really painful. It doesn't have to be really time consuming. It doesn't have to be really expensive. So particularly when you're little and there's only a few things going through, actually filing your VAT returns probably not really that much of a big deal, you know, each month, and it's all, you know, all done digitally now. So if you do want to scale, thinking about it really early means that there's not a big shocker. You know, you are reclaiming on stuff as well as you go up. You're not getting to the point. One of the things we hear from small businesses is that, you know, my competition isn't VAT registered, so they can charge lower prices. And I think you need to maybe adjust how you see that, you know, like maybe think that actually they're not my competition. This is the market I'm going for. I'm going for a bigger market. I'm going to sell more. I'm going to go for a bigger geographical area. Maybe I'm going to sell online. Maybe I'm going to sell to the whole UK. So I think kind of reframing the question, I think, can often help you kind of move through this. But I mean, also kind of acknowledging there's lots of businesses that sort of start up, not quite accidentally, but just sort of little, and then sort of develop, and suddenly you're like, oh, this is going somewhere, as opposed to having this very strategic vision about eventually scaling. The VAT thresholds may change when the government changes. It may change over the next couple of years. It's hard to know exactly what's going to happen with that. You know, a year ago it was 75. Can't remember.
85.
Yeah, yeah. And then it got put up to 90 in the last budget. So it does change. So you do, you know, remember Michael's words. Know what's going on. Know your money.
Can we just share a really big tip that all of us agreed about just before we actually even came on the call? Something that's really easy to do. Make sure you've got a savings account set aside and you put your VAT and tax in it. That is not your money to spend. And that is one of the things that when I was in business banking that I used to get most inquiries about, can you fund me for the VAT and the tax I've spent? Not easily. It is doable out in the marketplace, but it's not easy. So always, you know, if you've not got one set up already and you are thinking about growing, or even just having one set aside, you know, have a separate, you can have it linked to your, you know, your business still, but have a savings account and put money in it every single month or every week, however your business operates, you know. And even if you put 20% in it, you've then got contingency money. If nothing less, you've got contingency money. But then don't be like, as Suzanne mentioned before, you might then be faced with a tax bill or a VAT bill. You've then got some money sitting there. As I say, it's not your money to spend.
Good tips. Good tips. It's not your money to spend. Always remember that. Know your money, but know what is not your money. Right. I want to spend the last 10 minutes cost saving. We've got so many questions on cost saving. And I think this can really vary by business, by sector, by, you know, the nature of the business and where and where you're at. But so many people, I think this is driven a lot by the economic situation we're in. We know, you know, the economy sort of flatlined in April. There's hope that things will pick up a bit over the summer, but it's not been sunny uplands for a little while now. And we did have a little mini recession over the winter as well. So we're looking at our business. We're thinking, do you know what? It's hard. It's very hard to drive that top line. Remember, in a P&L, the top line is what we're looking at. Thinking about the bottom line, how do we go about saving costs? I'm going to come to Sue first, if that's okay.
I would, again, just like I would literally, as we mentioned before, get my bank statement out and actually analyse it. What am I spending out on what basis? And is it actually, you know, what terms am I paying people on? You know, am I paying them immediately when actually I could get credit terms with that particular supplier? You know, so it might be that therefore I can then keep some money in my business a little bit longer to help my cash flow. But yeah, I would literally just like look down everything, see what I'm spending, and then, you know, see actually which bits are there. And also the other part of it that we've not really spoken about, like, and I'm going to call it a widget, because a lot of companies don't just sell one item. You know, is there things in it that actually, you know, that have a smaller profit margin on them compared to another product? And just think, you know, how do you actually, you know, sell some more of the ones that with a higher higher profit margin on them? But yeah, I think cost savings is literally, you've just got to sit and analyze, you know, everything to see how much you're paying in and how often you're paying it. And have you got duplicates? And is there a provider that can give you the same service, but it for better value?
Any thoughts to add on that one, Suzanne and Michael?
Shall I go first? Okay, so So yeah, so you've done exactly what Sue said. You've analysed all your stuff. I think conversations, because people sometimes forget that you can talk to each other. And so I've analysed my costs. I've looked at how much I'm paying out for rent or for all these different costs. Well, actually, if I speak to my landlord and explain to them, I've projected and I can see I'm going to go into a poor period. Well, actually, my landlord might want to help me. And so conversations, or I've reviewed my costs and I think, oh, I'm paying a little bit too much out insurance now. Well, I'm going to speak to my insurance broker and see what they can do to help me. So I think that's what I would say. Speak to people, explain your situation, and just see what they can do to help.
Suzanne, anything to add to that one?
No, all very good advice. And I would just add, once you've done it once, don't think that's it. And you can leave it like for a long time. Go back and revisit it 6 months later just to make sure that nothing has crept in the interim, because it's an ongoing thing. It's not something you just do once. You've got to be on top of it all the time.
Yeah.
Okay, right. We're going to run out of time, but what I'd like to do just before we wrap up at the end is ask our esteemed panelists for their top tip. So there's loads of questions still coming in. Does an SME need to get insurance via a broker? No, you absolutely don't. But we can come back to that one at another time. Everyone's top tip. Thinking about a lot of the questions that have come in around managing cash flow, managing profitability for my business, being on top of things, knowing where I'm going, making a plan. I think I really get the sense there's a real kind of nervousness with small businesses and their financial skills. And one of the things that we find repeatedly is, of course, you start a business, not with like an MBA or an accounting qualification. You start a business because you're good at a thing or you love a thing, and suddenly you're now expected to do everything across that business. And you're not going to be an accounting expert. You're not going to be a legal expert. I mean, I think I'll go back to some of the things we've talked about. In my experience, ask an expert. We've got some lovely experts here today, and we've got the other session coming up as well. But do ask an expert. I've been in business for a very long time now, in one way or another. And I remember the early years not having an accountant and not asking an accountant. I just think all the time I wasted, all the money I wasted. It might seem like spending a bit of cash, getting things a bit automated, getting things in order. But that money will always be well spent, always be well spent. Now I've given you a minute to think about your top tip. Who would like to go first on my panel?
I
I
don't
will.
mind.
Oh, go on, Suzanne. You. Go on, you,
Okay.
Suzanne.
All right, fine. I'm a firm believer in having a support network. Michelle, absolutely. I tell all my new clients that building up a new business, you need a support network. So firmly agree with that. But my top tip I would probably say is there is so much technology out there. Use it to run your business as efficiently as you can. Okay. So use the payment apps to make sure you collect your money on time. Use the cash flow features in various bits of accounting software to help you plan your cash flow. Technology is there to be used, and with AI as well, it's going even further. So use it.
Right, and AI is kind of it's moving at such a pace, and I think sometimes small businesses can feel like it's a bit remote to them, but it can do incredible things like look through all your expenditure and suggest ideas, even this hive mind that's going to come and help you. I love that. Michael, you wanted to speak as well.
Yes, I'd say keep it simple, because a lot of questions today are about how do I do a forecast, how do I do a cash flow? Well, maybe the task that, as you said, professionals can help you with so that you can concentrate on your business. Because if you try and do everything yourself, you might find that you're spending hours and days coming up with all these nice, lovely charts and numbers. But actually, is it going to add value to your business when you could have been concentrating on your business? So keep things simple.
I love that. And you know what? It's easy to forget that your time has got a value too. And if you spend a week trying to sort out your finances when a professional could do it in half a day, that's cost you money. That has cost you money as well. Sue, last words to you.
So I think both of what Michael and Suzanne said, but I think, you know, knowing about your network as well, remember that there are a network of people out there that you can go to that are not going to charge you. And what I mean by that is go to a networking event, you know, for businesses. Everybody's probably been in the same boat as you at one point, and just actually speaking to them is really useful as well. And like Mike said, you know, keep it simple. And the other thing that I've, as I mentioned previously on the call, is make sure you have time to actually look at your business and not, you know, so work on the business, not always in it. And the other bit is don't be afraid to follow up on your invoices. I think a lot of people hate doing the invoices. So my advice is do the tasks you hate doing first in the day. There's a really good book called Eat That Frog. Get rid of that first task that you hate doing, if so, and then the rest of your day will be much, much better.
It's true. And I'm going to put a plug in there for networking too. And it's, you know, it's not just about, you know, you could meet people to sell to and, you know, that kind of old fashioned way of thinking about it. You meet people that are going to build your confidence, that are going to help you with little problems, that they actually, your network, local people, are great ways to recommend local accountants or bookkeepers, you know, people they trust, people that they've had really good advice from. You know, if there's something that you're grappling with, if you're not sure, maybe they've got sailed through the VAT threshold, you know, and they can share their experiences. It's going to make you feel more confident, more optimistic, more in control of things as well. And that's, you know, the best way to put the best foot forward, I think, for your business. I think Emma's going to pop a couple of slides on the screen, which are going to magically appear. Beautiful technology. So there's loads and loads of help available on the Lloyds Bank Academy. Well, it's completely free, just like Small Business Britain stuff. All the stuff on the Academy is completely free. Don't be a Lloyds customer. Go in, dip in. There's things like taking control of your revenue and cash flow, receiving online payments, digital skills, loads and loads of free training available. And that's, you know, we'd always say go and get the free stuff. Go and get the free stuff first before you pay for it. And never feel like you're on your own. You know, as a tiny businesses, most of us are micro businesses, you know, lots and lots of sole traders, solo entrepreneurs. You're really not alone. There is so much help and support out there. Our wonderful panel here today, all of us at Small Business Britain, all the stuff on the Lloyds Bank Academy. So tap into it. You know, don't feel on your own. Go and get some help and advice, and things will get better. They absolutely will. Look, I want to say a massive thank you to my panel. We can get rid of this thing if you've got the QR code. We'll leave it on the screen while I say goodbye. Thank you so much, Sue. Thank you so much, Suzanne. Thank you so much, Michael. Love this comments. This session has been epic. Yes, it has been epic. I've really enjoyed it. Thank you so much for your really wonderful, sharp and down-to-earth advice, my panel today. It's been absolutely wonderful. We will see you in a week's time, I think, for the next in this session. I love it when the hearts pop up the side, by the way, of the webinar. That always makes me happy. I love to see the hearts. So thanks for that, everybody. We will be back soon. This session is recorded. You may be watching it on catch up, in which case, hello. But if not, we will send you a copy. So if there's anything that you want to go back and dip into, do feel free to. Anything that you need for your business, anything you're worried about, always drop us a line. hello@smallbusinessbritain.uk. Have a great week, everyone, and we'll see you all very soon. Cheers.
Bye. Thank you. Bye.